This was my boy, Emmett Till.
I got a letter today from Auntie Lizzie. She said Bo's been working the fields.
Oh. I can't imagine.
Oh, he just doesn't understand how different things are in Mississippi. Are you listening?
Yes.
Be small down there.
Like this?
Emmett never thought anything would happen to him.
Meet the mummy, Simmy!
He just wanted to go on vacation and have fun with his cousins. But if my son could just get his feet back onto the Chicago soil, he'd be one happy kid. I don't know why I said that.
That boy.
They've come for you.
It's hard to describe what a mother knows. The first thing I noticed when I became a mother was that my hands were busy all the time. My hand knew him with my eyes closed. Just like I know his laughter in a crowded room. It's the same thing when you know all of someone. This was my boy, Emmett Till.
The body of Emmett Lewis Till has been found dead.
Can I at least just fix him up a bit?
No, they have to see it for themselves.
You tell me, Mamie, how is risking your life gonna help them?
Those pictures of your son change people's lives.
I can't look, baby. We have to.
The lynching of my son has shown me that what happens to any of us anywhere in the world had better be the business of us all.
Mamie Till, Emmett's mother, made the courageous decision to have his casket open for his viewing. People could see what they had done to her son. In the trailer, one of the ladies says she can't look at the body, and Mamie says, we have to. Friends, no matter how challenging or uncomfortable it may be, face society's history, systemic racism, we must do so. If we do not face these atrocities, then we're bound to repeat them and there will be no change in the future. I feel this movie is extremely important for everybody to go see. Not only because it will cause you to wrestle with America's past, but it will implore you to carefully examine its present. As I watched this trailer for the first time, I felt overwhelmed with sadness and anger. I'm sure many of you felt similar emotions. Because the killing of innocent black people still happens today. It's pretty easy for me to recall Duante Wright, Ahmed Aubrey, Breonna Taylor, and so many others. Most notably, in Minnesota, George Floyd. I remember how much heartbreak his death caused all over the world, but especially for the BIPOC community. in the midst of this story, there are millions of gang members left without a brother, sister, mother, father, uncle, aunt, etc. As I think of these families forever destroyed, I know that the hardest thing for a parent to deal with is the loss of a child. A child dying before their parent is a parent's complete and worst nightmare. In our book, the example of Mamie Till, and I note her strength. She wasn't an activist, she was a mother, but she became an activist because she felt she had to. And with that, she gave an infamous quote that goes, "What happens to any of us, anywhere in the world, had better be the business of us all." Now friends, I want you to think about these words for a moment. Her words are a call to action. That we can still answer today. The scripture tells us, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart." God created each and every one of us with unique gifts and talents. And this scripture affirms that every single person has inherent worth and dignity. And even though our world tries to send the opposite message, we know that as Christians, we are set apart. We know that we are called to live counterculturally. And we were created for a specific time and purpose. Friends, that time and purpose is now. For some of you, I know that it can be hard to trust God at times. I'm not lying. When I say that trusting God when you're going through dark storms is one of the most difficult things in the world to do. But friends, in your trepidation, you are not alone. In fact, there are many instances in the Bible where others have had the exact same feelings. Jeremiah told God, "I'm too young." Moses said to God, "I'm not an eloquent speaker." Isaiah thought he was unworthy, and yet God called him anyway. Friends, we can rest in the assurance that the God who calls will also sustain. Anybody can make a difference and affect change. You don't have to be an ordained minister for your life to create an impact on others, because you never know how God is going to use you. The text continues on. But the Lord said to Jeremiah, "Do not say, 'I am too young.' You must go to everyone I command you to. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you." We all feel like Jeremiah at times, not really up to the text. But does that mean that our actions are any less important? Why would God put something on your heart if not for you to act? A few weeks ago, my husband and I were having coffee with his mother and her sister. And we're enjoying the time together to fellowship and having a lighthearted conversation when my husband turns to his aunt. And he says, "I just wanted to thank you. You know, I never told you this, but a few years ago, I was going through a really dark time. And the word that you said to me when I visited you planted a seed, a very small seed, because it was very dark at that time, but a seed nonetheless, that continued to grow and grow and grow. Until I believed things would get better. I believed that there was hope for my future. And that was all because of you." I found it very beautiful that he wanted to express how grateful he was to her for just a few words she had said and a few encouragements she had given years ago, because it really shows how important it is to speak life and build people up. Friends, when God places something on your heart, it is not a coincidence. You're feeling that tug because God has placed that there. I know there can be times when you might not know what to say. Are you worried? Are my words going to be perfect, or are they going to make sense? Our text today tells us God will give us the words. And if that's not enough, the NASS Johnston Concordance says, words can be translated to mean concerns, advice, counsel, intuition. And that's what Don's aunt, my husband's aunt, showed us. She spoke words that encouraged him, built him up, and gave him new life. How can you do this for others? What do you feel God has called you to do? What do you need to act on that God has put on your heart? Where do you need to further grow to continue to nourish seeds that were already planted in your life? Arthur Ashe, an American tennis player who's the first and only black man to win the US Open and Wimbledon single titles, gives us this advice. He says, start where you are, use what you have, and do what you can. Start by taking the first step. Even if it's a small, baby step, it's the first step into the right direction. It's the first step into where God is calling you. Because remember, you never know how God is going to use you. In Feasting on the Word, David Bartlett and Barbara Taylor Brown explain that God's call can be difficult. Our role in bearing the Word into the world today, whatever our role in bearing the Word into the world today, we should not be surprised to find ourselves involved in confrontation. God's commitment to right worship, self-giving, and care for society's least has not changed. And God yearns over humanity with a love too profound to turn a blind eye to our self-absorption and self-deceit, indifference or intolerance. There will be times when the anguish of God claims for us bold word and action. Only God's promise to sustain us will make the work bearable. In facing America's history of systemic racism, we must continue the work that has already been started. The movie Till reminds us of the work of the Civil Rights Movement and how much work there still is to do today. Work to dismantle systems, policies, and social structures that contribute to racism. Tanisha Peoples wrote in the Black Wall Street Times, many of us think that activism is limited to standing on the front lines of some massive public protest with media presence, but that's not true. The truth of the matter is, everyone has a voice and the ability to advocate in the preferred lane, because all of them are gridlocked with injustice, inequality, and inequity. Find what is in your lane. Maybe you prefer signing a petition, or calling your senator, or supporting a black-owned business. How can you join the fight against systemic racism today? As Dr. King says, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. equipped you with certain gifts. And all our gifts are for the glory of God. God has chosen you at this moment in time. Tanisha Peoples implores us. There are Emmett Tills still being murdered in the streets by police, and others that are dying slow deaths due to homelessness, incarceration, lack of access to health care, mental health services, and other societal defects because they've been discarded. Elevate your voice for the voiceless. Clearly state that you denounce racism in all its forms, that you want to stop the killing of innocent Black people and fight against an unjust system. We have to do better for the millions of families that do not need to lose another loved one too soon. Did you know that if Emmett Till was alive today, he would be 80 years old? This did not happen that long ago. This is still happening today. And maybe Till's words still call us. What happens to any of us, anywhere in the world, had better be the business of us all. How can you stand with the Black Lives Matter movement? What big or small steps can you take to fight against injustices in your community and world today? Friends, let us make injustice our business.